A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Alladhi hadana li hadha wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadanallah. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen. Shafi'i dhunubina wa tabibi nufusina wa habibi qulubina bil Qasimi Muhammad. وعليه الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين ولعنة الله الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته أعظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم بمصابنا بأبي عبد الله الحسين عليه الصلاة والسلام. We have been stating that Islam as a religion has got the broadest tenets to ensure a successful life, meaningful life, a life filled with purpose, a realistic purpose, and that purpose is then attained through Islam's instruction of how to lead a meaningful life. And in that we get these four main tenets: God and individual, here and hereafter. God is the direction, individual is the subject being directed. When we talk about the individual, we're actually talking about the individual in the individual capacity and the collective capacity. Here and hereafter are there to regulate the interactions of human beings and to make them purposeful and to direct them towards the attainment of the goal. In that we stated that Islam has been very, very mindful of the way in which the human being is. It has realistically appreciated what we have termed human nature. And that is to appreciate human nature in line with the properties of existence, which is nothing other than evolution, growth, self-realization. That then brings a lot of other properties, such as relativity, absoluteness, individuality. Islam has been mindful of all of them when we look at the instructions of Islam. Now, in these broad tenets, we stated that whatever falls within them will be open to evaluation, interpretation, critique. There is no permanence for any of them. Permanence is only for the core meaning that is there within any instruction, and that is that it should be balanced between the here, hereafter, and it must be in line with allowing the human to achieve his objective. So whatever falls in the middle, we stated, whether it is the Islamic culture, Islamic law, Islamic sense of morality, Islamic theology, all of these are to be seen as human interpretation of the real state of Islam. So long as they are able to bring about that balance and aid and help that human growth, they are sacred. When they lose that, they lose their sacredness, and they need to be understood afresh in line with that salient principle of growth. Now this is quite a dangerous thing to say, because then it suggests a non-fixed state of Islam, a mutable state of Islam, as opposed to an Islam that we have understood as something immutable, something that will not change for as long as humankind exists upon the face of this earth. This is exactly what we are saying. As odd as it may appear, as blasphemous as it might seem, but this is exactly what we are suggesting. And we will evidence this as we go along in the lectures that are to come, that when we talk about the reality of deen, it is nothing other than in sync with the human evolutionary trend. Just as existence evolves, the human individual is evolving and the human community is evolving, and as they evolve, everything that they know that they do must necessarily be subject to evolution. And Islam, in its formative era, has demonstrated this to us. But now we ask, well, all this as talk is fine, but can we give it a theological color? We will say yes, by all means. The Quran talks about salvation. It talks about success. And we truly, when we look at the meaning of salvation, it actually means the realization of a thing to its utmost potential. When something arrives at the peak of actualizing its potential, it is known as a state of salvation. The Quran says, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Those are they who have attained salvation, or those are they who have attained success. فَلَحَ also means to open up. Open up and to burst forth. What burst forth is the potential that is hidden within it. These broad tenets that we have been talking about have been present within the Quran, and the Quran has always spoken about them. It talks about salvation. It talks about success. It talks about Iman Billah, faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the faith in the hereafter. And it talks about Amalus Salih. And these are the things that encapsulate everything that we have been saying. When it talks about Iman Billah, this is exactly what we have been saying. God-centricity. That God becomes the focal point. When it talks about belief in the hereafter, it is talking about self-realization and the completion of the potential that is there. And before we go further, if we were to take the deliberations of our mystics, they would always ask, well, why is it known as the Day of Judgment? Why is it not known as the Moment of Judgment, or the Event of Judgment, or the Phase of Judgment, or the Era of Judgment? Why does Allah call it the Yawm? Because in daytime are things distinguished for what they are worth. You will see a thing for what it is worth when light shines upon it. Otherwise, as Rumi says, at nighttime copper and gold exchanges hands, goes about interchangeably without anybody knowing what is what. It is only in the daytime that you arrive at a point of discretion where you can see what is what. And therefore the Day of Judgment is seen as the objective that we are reaching out. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seen as the direction. On the other hand, the Amalus Salih, righteous deeds that appear within the Quran, is a whole state of those balanced actions that are designed to bring about self-realization. In this way, we have said, Islam is highly spiritual because at the core of all our being is that spiritual yearning for something real. And that something real cannot be something arbitrary to us. In the concretest sense, it has to be with me, or with my community, or with my whole human society. Indeed, when we look at eschatology in the lectures that are to come, we will point this out once again in a much fuller sense, evidencing it through our literature. But just as a Christmas tree is adorned with all the decor and decoration, we will say to the Christmas tree, you are serving a momentary purpose for the beholder, yet you have failed to attain your own purpose. Your purpose was to grow and to finish your journey. Your growth has abruptly been brought to an end, and now you are becoming a piece of decor and decoration. You are adorned for the pleasure of others, yet you have not fulfilled yourself. completion has to come in a realistic sense from within. And this is what makes us highly spiritual people. I want to know why I am here. Islam immediately gives me the broader context. This is the reason why you are here. What is the meaning of life? To arrive at the completion of your own self. There is no answer but you. You are the answer. How amazing, a seed goes to the apple tree and says, what is my purpose? The apple tree says, look at me, I am your purpose. It is not the purpose. Because a tree of pears will say, I am your purpose. And an orange tree will say, I am your purpose. None of them are the purpose. The purpose is hidden deep within the heart of that seed. And until and unless the seed allows itself to be broken, the purpose shall never be attained. Similarly, there are no answers, I'm bringing this in right now, there are no answers in the tongues of the prophets nor within the Quran. The answer is there within the individual. The answer is there within the community. The Quran is at most a reminder for the awakening of the real answer. The prophet is the tongue to bring about realization within me. In this way we are highly spiritual. And the only way I will be satisfied is when I begin to attain my own self. Immediately, Allah is appointed as the center and focus of my existence. And that gives purpose to me. Now look at the beautiful way. We want to work towards something that will then give us an understanding of the greater state of Islam. And that will be something that will follow through in the rest of the lectures. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala involves himself in such a meaningful way within this religion. In Surah Al-An'am, from ayat 95 onwards, and obviously I'll just cite parts of ayats because we have to deal with quite a few verses today. Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَالِقُ الْحَبِّ وَالنَّوَى. Allah is the one who opens up the seed and the date stone. يُخْرَجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ وَمُخْرَجُ الْمَيِّتِ مِنَ الْحَيِّ. He is the one who brings forth the living from the dead and dead from the living. فَالِقُ الْإِصْبَاحِ. He is the one who brings this day to prevail upon the night and night to prevail upon the day. وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ النُّجُومِ لَتَحْتَدُوا. And he has made for you the stars so that you might be guided aright. خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدًا. He has created you from a single soul. أَنزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَخْرَجَ بِهِ نَبَاتَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. He has revealed from the heavens water and through it brought forth every type of fruit and plantation. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is involving himself in every working of nature. He is bringing to highlight that tenet of tawheed and unity, that only I am the direction. Direct yourself towards me, and that is the sense of purpose that you have within you awaiting to realize itself. And then the way he involves himself in every mundane aspect of human life. He talks about contracts within Surah Baqarah. At the end of every verse, or second or third verse, he says, but Allah is watching you. Be mindful. Allah is the third one in this contract. He talks about warfare in Surah Ali Imran. And at every point involves himself. He talks about people's psychology and involves himself. He talks about people running away from the battlefield, talks about himself. He talks about people being encouraged to fight, talks about himself. He's talking to them at all points that, look, I am intrinsically involved, inextricably involved in all of these events. He talks about people at the level deep of their own, within their own psychology, and says, even there, it is me listening to you. He talks about interactions of people in closed groups. He says, I am the third one, I am the fourth one, I am the fifth one. He talks about wills and says, Allah is there, be mindful. He talks about fasts. He says, Allah is there so that you may return to Him. He talks about salah. He talks about zakat. Whatever he talks about, he brings this notion of the centrality of his own self. That I am the center point here. You are working towards me, you are attaining me. This is what makes life so meaningful for you. And as we stated, Islam, the very word suggests willful, conscious submission to the other. And the whole agenda of the Quran has been, مَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لَيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created man or jinn except that they may worship me. The whole of this thing is pointing at the centrality of God and human as the subject evolving towards God. This is the way in which Islam liberates the human being and allows the human being to realize his own self and the community. It is only when I submit myself to a higher order that I truly begin to move. And to be honest with you, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states that I have not created man and jinn except for worship, it is an existential property that He is talking about. He is not talking about things in arbitrary terms. What He means to say is that the human beings can never be outside the framework of worship. Worship and subservience and submission is only to growth promoting factors. Me and you, whether we like it or not, are always submitted to factors that promote growth in our minds. The reason that I work for 16 hours as opposed to 8 is because I want to earn capital that gives me growth in my own presumption. The reason why I read books, the reason why I strive for my children, all these are factors that promote growth in my own mind. And Allah has said this, that I have not created you except for worship. Whether you like it or not, you are in a state of worship. But what is intended here is directed submission. When there is directed submission, there is wholesome fulfillment from within. This aspect of Tawheed, therefore, becomes that Iman Billah and that central tenet that we've been talking about. That we are flowing towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the way in which Allah has given us the laws within Islam, morality and spirituality within Islam, everything is directed towards the unity of Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. This is a very, very important aspect. Whereas a human being is a very dispersed and dissipated entity, we are always scattered from within ourselves. The first thing this religion does is, it brings about this focus, this point of gravity, where everything can gravitate and come together. At this point in time, why am I so scattered within my own self? There are two reasons. I am scattered within my own self because I don't have that direction. Two, I am scattered within myself because my community is fully scattered. It is not focused at all on the axis of Tawheed. If we can introduce this Tawheed meaningfully in our lives, like the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is introducing Himself, in contract law, in warfare, in the way in which a state is governed, so on and so forth, then there we find this beautiful focus. But there is another, a profound message waiting here. When we talk about this success through self-realization, immediately we will have to admit to the relativity of success. That there are no two people, nor two communities, nor two sects, nor religions that are the same in the way in which they attain themselves. We stated yesterday that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ لَيَهْدِي لِلَّذِي هُوَ أَقْوَمُ. That this Qur'an guides to that which is most firm. In accordance with the language of Qur'an, we begin to find that there isn't right, absolute and wrong. There is absolute right and wrong in terms of what we pointed out, the friend of God and enemy of God, that prevails across the board. But apart from that, there is right and there is lesser right. This is right. That too is right. But in contrast with this, that is a lesser right. A lesser degree of attainment of the self, or self-realization, or of the truth. And Allah indicates at this again and again within the Quran. He states, do you not see? We sent forth rain from the heavens. It slips into the earth and flows within the valleys. Through it, we cause the growth of different types of plantation and trees. The pomegranates grow from it. The dates grow from it. The grapes grow from it. All of them are different. This is the absolute norm of existence, that there is relativity. Everything has a different sense of attainment. This is exactly what we've been trying to say about Islam. That Islam may not be what me and you understand. A state of absolute right as opposed to the state of absolute wrong in the way that we have understood. Because today our understanding is that Islam is right. Every other religion is false. Which Islam? The Islam that me and you have interpreted is absolutely right. This is the way we understand it, don't we? That might not be the case at all. In terms of the real Islam, even this Islam that me and you practice might not be the fullest acquisition of the self. Might be a partial acquisition. And we might be inviting, might be, we may be being invited by Allah to a greater level of self-realization. If we can understand that, then we begin to see immediately that there needn't be a right and a wrong. There can be a right and a lesser right that grows towards the greater right. Maybe at this point an example is in order. Ayatullah Tabatabai, when he talks about Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, he makes this comment that in the Quran we find different terms for paths. We find Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path, and we find the term Sabil and Subul, the way and ways. And he who strives in our ways, and he who strives in us, we shall guide him our ways. Now Tabatabai states that this is to be understood, although he doesn't say it in that way. Is the sound okay? He doesn't say it in this way, but this is exactly what he means. He states that maybe this is to be understood in line with evolution, as we stated, from weakness to strength. That subul are the immediate paths that we take. Sirat is the eventual course of self-realization that is composed of many different subuls changing hands one by one, one after another. What does that mean? That what is right for me at the age of 20 may no longer be right for me at this ripe old age. What constituted righteousness in terms of morality and behavior at that age, because it aided to my growth, may no longer be right now. That thing may be wrong because it's counterproductive today, whereas it was productive in that stage of mine, in that evolutionary trend, when I've grown from weakness into strength. Now when I contrast my stage now to what I was 20 years ago, I will say that is wrong for me today, but it may be right for somebody else who finds themselves in the context in which I found myself 20, 30 years ago. So subul are these paths that change, come, exchange, but they all contribute towards me growing and realizing myself, and that is Siratul Mustaqim. Similarly, the communities, what was right for them when they came here 30, 40 years ago, in terms of their insecurity and wanting to guard their identity, in terms of saying, I am the other and not you, being exclusive, might have been right for them at that point. After getting roots here in this part of the world, today if they say and maintain that closed identity Islam and becoming exclusive, it might be totally counterproductive. And at this point right now, they are supposed to display a state of strength and say we are inclusive or we are pluralistic. And that would then be their truth today, as opposed to what the truth was yesterday. In a similar fashion, you have variety of religions, all of them in a different context altogether, all of them attaining themselves at different speeds, at different rates. They all have different dynamics. The one thing that binds all of them together is this unilateral surge, unidirectional surge towards completion. But all of them are pushing forward at different rates. So when we talk about salvation, immediately this meaning of relativity pops into it. But beyond that, it gives another subtle meaning as well. And that is that the different interpretations of Islam may all be valid so long as those four tenants are alive, reaching out to God, I am completing myself. A balance between here, hereafter, yielding a morality that adds the spirit to the spirituality. So long as they fall within those tenets, they might all be accurate. We stated yesterday, and I want to make this point again, that the reason God has left His instructions within the Quran ambiguous is in order to accommodate this multifaceted, relativistic growth of different communities in different regions. The only reason He has left those verses ambiguous is because He wants to accommodate growth in its entirety. That different people understand the same thing differently at different regions. And if I am able to give a very mundane example, our ulama, in terms of their paradigm that they had back in the day of the superiority of Islam and the nature of Christians and Jews being the protected entities within the state of Islam, interpreted the texts of the Quran in a way that is wholly unbefitting today. That the Christians and the Jews are najis, so on and so forth, today. With this global Islam, a pluralistic community, we are looking at those texts again and we are saying none of them yield the meaning of impurity, physical impurity of the other. We have totally changed. The paradigm changes, we've changed. The texts are ambiguous enough for us to fluctuate and to move. The other subtle difference is that not only the different schools of thought, even the same school of thought is allowed through this notion of success, God-directedness, to re-evaluate itself and its own position and to move forward. And this is what we stated yesterday, that everything within these tenets is there to serve these tenets. And the sacredness is for the state of Islam, which is the state of growth towards Allah Jalla Jalaluhu, through a very balanced approach. So now the first thing Allah talks about in terms of success is belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now belief in Allah is seen as that direction. Now this direction He's not only talking about in loose terms, He is fixing it. That at every point, whether in terms of private life or public life, our psychology or dealing with others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should become the goal and the focal point. And this then brings the individual through wholesome submission to a state of their own completion. What is Amalus Salih therefore? We stated the terms in the Quran. It says, Muflihun Falah. It talks about Iman Billah wa Bil Yawmil Akhir. And he talks about Amalun Salih. And I want to go further in a little while into the verses. What is Amalus Salih? In accordance with what we have been explaining, Amalus Salih is therefore every human act and interaction that is balanced between the here, hereafter, and driven towards the objective, and that is self-realization and attainment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That will constitute Amalus Salih. Now at times we don't know what Amalus Salih is, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us like Salah. Salah is Amalus Salih. In terms of social norms, caring for the other, or giving taxes for the welfare of the other, welfare of the community, is Amalus Salih. So on and so forth. What we are trying to drive at is that the tenets of success, and therefore the real Islam, are only three. And they are what? Belief in Allah and the hereafter. And performance of righteous deeds. Look at the Quran. Verse after verse after verse. When it talks about Jannah, when it talks about success, it is talking about belief in Allah, the hereafter and righteous deeds. It is omitting the prophets altogether. There is no centrality to any belief in any of the prophets. وَإِذَا لَكُلَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. In Baqarah we have this verse. When the hypocrites meet the believers, they say, we believe in Allah, we believe in the hereafter. And Allah says, they are not believers. Why have they omitted the Prophet altogether in their statement? And why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not see the centrality of the belief in the Prophet? verse after verse, all of them are stating belief in Allah, belief in the hereafter and righteous deeds, and that is enough for salvation. As we said, it might not be a standard salvation. There might be grades of salvation and gradation of salvation. You might not have the case of right and everything else being wrong. You might have the case of right and lesser rights. Wherever it falls between the parameter of absolute right and absolute wrong, which is friend of God and enemy of God, we need to clarify. We need to make that clear as far as possible. Now look at those verses that talk about salvation. And they talk about the Prophet. The verse, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Say, if you profess love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow my example, Allah will love you. Immediately in this verse we find that there is no centrality to the Prophet. Centrality is only to Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. If you love Allah, follow me, Allah will love you. The beginning is Allah, the end is Allah. There is no centrality to the Prophet at all. Another verse. وَلَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. Indeed, you have a prime example in the Messenger of Allah for the one who wishes Allah and the hereafter. Again, the centrality of the Prophet is removed. قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشْرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ وَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو. What does it say? وَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Say, I am an individual. It has been revealed upon me that your Lord is one. And he who wishes to meet with his Lord, then let him perform righteous deeds. In none of these verses has there been any centrality to the Prophet. Look at the verses, verse upon verse upon verse. When it talks about salvation, it is omitting Prophet altogether. Not only the final Prophet, it is omitting every Prophet. The tenets of success have only been God, the hereafter and righteous deeds. And we've interpreted God to mean that beautiful direction through worship where we lose ourselves and allow this completion to evolve. Hereafter is talking about the attainment of the objective, the final objective, and that is my success. And amalun salih, the righteous deeds, are those deeds that bring about this beautiful balanced state that directs me towards my completion. If religion is to be understood in this context, then we can see how it can allow for its own reinterpretation. We can see that in the modern era, all the problems that we are having, they needn't be a problem for us at all. If we were to refer to the original community of the Prophet, we will see this evolutionary trend within them. Surah Baqarah or Surah Ali Imran? I think it's Surah Baqarah. In Surah Baqarah, when the Muslim community was formed within Medina and they were being mocked at by the host community of Medina, in which the Jews were in a position of utmost strength and influence, the Prophet was still told, bear it and turn away from it. Immediately after a few verses, the Prophet is told, now respond to them. Why? Because this community of the Prophet was weak at one level. Then it acquired utmost level of strength. And at utmost level of strength, it was told to withstand its ground and to respond to them. But then when it was told to respond to them, don't respond to them in the way that they have been dealing with you, by cursing them and placing them in the pits of hell, but by telling them that no, come together with us on that word that is equally shared between us and you, that we shall not worship other than Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. It was its own evolutionary trend, but even in its own evolutionary trend, it was growing, not becoming narrower and constricted. As opposed to the present day of our Islam, It starts from a pedestal of broadness, parameters that were not fixed, that were flexible, from a state of expansion. And today it's become to a state of constriction, where it identifies itself in opposition to the other. The prophetic community grew from a position of being the other to being to a position of being one that is all-inclusive of the other. That is the natural progression. And that is exactly what the meaning of the Quran was. That success is not only yours in terms of what you formalistically believe. Now, we take this hadith of the Prophet that Islam shall divide into 73 sects, 72 will be in fire. First and foremost, the Prophet cannot speak so loosely. The 72 are in fire. The Prophet cannot speak so loosely. Secondly, if the Prophet has said this, then fire does not mean hell and damnation. In his own way, if somebody were to study the use of the word fire, it probably means are in error, as opposed to being in fire. It means in error, because it doesn't make sense. If there is a Sunni brother of mine who very sincerely believes whatever he understands to be righteous, he is not an enemy of God. He has all the makings of a beautiful soul. He is directed towards Allah, realizing his own beautiful self. He is acting in a balanced state that adds to a moral being. Then that man is more successful than any Shia given on the face of this earth who is not attaining the same spiritual ascension. It doesn't make sense at all. The fire will have to be reinterpreted to mean in error. We can say this man is in error, yet he is successful. It's simple as that. You are doing this course, you are supposed to read those books, not this book. But accidentally, you will come across the same material in those books and you will still pass your exam. You are in error for taking paracetamol to relieve you of a headache, whereas it was supposed to be in order to remove fever. But accidentally, it will remove your headache as well. You're in error, but you are still successful. When the Prophet said, Islam will divide into 73 sects, and 72 will go to hell. He did not say will go to hell. He said they will be in fire. In fire doesn't mean this. Do you not see the problems and how we have been plagued due to this thinking? That I am the right one, the other is the wrong. An absoluteness of right and wrong. And no notion of relativity. No notion of those central tenets that the Quran is talking about. It is squarely due to this sort of an understanding that we are facing every problem that we are facing in Islam. Even in our community, the reason why the community has stagnated to the level to which it has stagnated is squarely based on this. That the humanness has been denied to Islam altogether. Where have you not seen in your workplaces, in children being educated, in classes, that people take different routes and they all arrive at the same goal? And where have you seen two people being equally successful? You can never find it. It's highly relative. People are very, very different. Now, when the Prophet said that the Islam will divide into 73 sects and 72 will be in hell does not mean what we've understood. And secondly, when he says they will be divided into 73 sects and 72 will be in hell, you and I think we are the one who is going to heaven? Seriously? Is that what you imagine? And is that what I imagine? This nonsense is going to paradise. To be honest with you, if Allah gives me that paradise, I'll run away from it. Of course I won't. I'll go into it. But my sense of self-respect will tell me to tell Allah, I don't deserve this, and you know that. In this community, if they are so complacent into thinking that we are going to go to paradise, then let them think again that within this community itself, there are subdivisions. And those subdivisions are 73. Out of which 72 are going to hell. And of the one that will remain, as soon as they arrive at 73 number of individuals, there will be 73 interpretations and 72 are going to hell. You will end up with heaven being empty. People say to me, will have Christians and Jews go to heaven? I say, I hope they do, otherwise the heaven will be empty because no Muslim is going there. When the Prophet said this, it is to be understood very, very differently. It is to be understood in a very realistic sense that the tenets of success are these. God, human being, here, hereafter. Belief in Allah, belief in hereafter, and amalu salih, and that yields success. No two people's success is the same. One success is greater than the other one. It does not mean that the other one is wrong. Just as an apple tree completes its journey by becoming fruit-bearing tree, so does an orange tree complete its journey by becoming a fruit-bearing tree. Both of them are very different from each other, and both of them are successful. The central tenets have been satisfied. Finish. Anything opposing the central tenets is not succeeding at all. And that is why we have this absoluteness only in terms of friend of God and enemy of God. You can be a Shia all your life, beat your chest as much as you want, cry out, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein. You will find yourself, God forbid, sharing the same place as Yazid. If those four tenets are not met with. You can be a Wahhabi, but if you fall within this framework, you will be with Ali ibn Abi Talib and the Prophet. When we talk about these hadiths, actually most accurately, it is talking about one sect that is spread across the 73 sects. And that one sect is of people who are adhering to the truth and who are growing, for whom truth is the most worthy thing, not the tongue that is supplying it. The people who are submitted to God and not to their own self, a community that is focused through God in attainment of itself and are not deterred by this and that. We are going to talk at length about the whole issue of responsibility. If an individual feels the sense of responsibility towards Allah and attainment of itself through the truth, then that person is the person on the path of absolute success. Whether they're spread within the Shia sects, Sunni sects, Christian sects, Jewish sects, Hindu sects, Buddhist sects, wherever they may be. But in having said all of that, the formalistic Islam is the only one that comes closest to the ideal state of human existence. We find all of these elements within the story of Hussein ibn Ali. Look at this. There is this man, Wahhab. Wahhab is a Christian. I, after reading the Maqatil, don't believe that this man understands anything of Tawheed. He doesn't. He doesn't understand Rasulullah. He doesn't know the Quran. He doesn't know any of these things. The only thing that happens is that his mother witnesses the face of Hussein ibn Ali and falls helplessly in love with Hussein. She rushes with him to Karbala, joins them on the day of Ashura maybe. The boy, realizing the righteous claim of Hussein ibn Ali and his state of being oppressed, gives his life and attains us most salvation and success. He has not prayed a single namaz. He doesn't even know the connotations of the word Allah. He has not read a verse of the Quran more than likely. He doesn't know what any of the Islamic junctions are. But he falls immediately within that framework and he has attained success immediately. And for Hussein ibn Ali, he is a Muslim. And he is a successful one. And as opposed to him, the whole army of Muslims that is killing him is headed for damnation. He was of that mindset. His Islam was that broad. He understood things very, very differently. Today we talk of a person that actually made a switch at the final moment. And when he makes that switch, Allah says in the Quran, and who other than Allah shall convert every evil deed into good deeds? When we fall within this broad four tenets, everything is changed. And success is guaranteed. When Hussein was en route to Kufa, somebody cried out, Allahu Akbar. Imam said, indeed Allah is great. But what makes you utter the takbir at this point? I see the date palms of Kufa he uttered. There were people with Hussein who knew the route well. They said, we are at a great distance from Kufa. When they looked closely, they found an army drowned in armor coming towards them. Hussein said, it is an army. It is approaching us. We will camp here. It was an army of 1,000, led by Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyah. Hur was a renowned warrior of Syria. When he came, Hussein could see the state of fatigue and thirst upon them. He stated to his clan and his family and his tribe, open the water skins and refeed them and let them quench their thirsts and even their animals. A person narrates that I was the last one, dying of thirst. Hussein saw me and my horse and he said, quench yourself and then quench your horse. Hussein was not doing this in terms of creating an impression upon their minds. He was doing this helplessly through the beauty of his humanity. Once they had drunk their water, Hajjaj bin Masruq called out the Adhan. Hussein ibn Ali went between the lines of his followers and Hur and his army. And he spoke, O people, it was at your invitation that we have come to Karbala, that we have come to this point and advanced towards Kufa. If you retract your invitations, then we shall leave and go back to our hometowns. Hussein looked at Hur and he said, lead your prayers, lead your people in prayers, as I shall lead mine. Hur said, but Hussein, we will pray behind you. They prayed Dhuhr behind Hussein. Imam Hussein again after Dhuhr stood and delivered a sermon. And he said, O people, we are the family and the lineage of the Prophet. And we are most worthy to lead the Muslim Ummah to the path of salvation. Not these people that have usurped the seat of Khilafah. It was you, through your insistence, that has forced me to come to this point. Who said, O Hussein, I know not of any letters that you talk about. Imam Hussein asked one of his companions to bring 2 sacks of letters. When they were brought, Hur said, I did not write any of them. The rest of the army lowered their heads. Hussein ascended his steed. As he ascended his steed, he said to Hur, O Hur, allow me to go to Kufa on my own accord, or allow me to leave and go back to my homeland. Hur grabbed the reins of Hussein's steed. As he grabbed the reins of Hussein's steed in audacity, Hussein looked at him and said, O Hur, may your mother weep in sorrow of your death. Startled, Hur moved back. He looked into the eyes of Hussein. By Allah, if anybody else were to have uttered this word about my mother, I would have reciprocated. But what may I say? When it comes to your mother, I bow humbly in salutations. Then Hur, softening his tone, O Hussein, I have been commanded not to leave you, either to take the pledge of allegiance from you for Yazid, or not to part company with you. Hur then looks at Hussein and says, O Hussein, I am certain, if you engage with this people, they shall put you to death. Hussein looked at Hur, أَتُخَوِّفُنِي بِالْمَوْتِ Do you frighten me with death, O Hur? What could be the greatest indignity than your own state, that you call yourself a free man, yet your nose is rubbed upon the earth in humility? There is no blemish upon a youth if he intends the truth and he fights for what he believes. If he dies a glorious death. If he lives without blemish. Hur falls silent. He accompanies Hussein. They arrive into Karbala. Hur is negotiating with Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad and others, that shall you engage in a battle with Hussein? There is no reply. It is now the eve of Ashura. Hur goes to Ubaidullah, to Umar ibn Sa'd, and he says, O Umar, shall you fight Hussein? He smiles, O Hur, within an hour you shall see their heads flying and their limbs being decapitated. As he said that, Hur trembles. As Hur retreats, he ascends his steed. He ascends his steeds and starts slowly moving towards the camp of Al-Hussein. A warrior accompanies him. He says to him, "Have you quenched your horse?" He says, "No." He says, "Go and give your war horse something to drink." He said, "O whore, I see your color change. I see you trembling in awe. Can it be that you are frightened of this small camp of people who die of thirst and hunger?" Who said, "By Allah, I see myself between paradise and hell. By Allah, I shall never prefer hell above paradise." As Hur made way towards Hussein's camp, his two sons and his brother and his slave joined him, and they all went. We hear this in popular narration, that Hur was mindful of the state of anxiety within both the camps. He came slowly to Hussein ibn Ali, least Abbas and Akbar see him a threat. He comes to Hussein and he says, "O Hussein, I come repentant to you. Is there forgiveness for me in your heart? O Hussein, I am the one who is responsible for bringing you into this place. It is due to me and my audacity that today you are surrounded by death." Hussein says, "O Hur, my Lord has forgiven you, as have I. O Hur, come to me and be with me." Hur says, "No, Hussein, let me be. Let me go and engage with your enemy and give my life." Hussein said, "Then be it." At that point, he hears cries emanating from the tents. He says, "O Hussein, allow me to address the daughters of Fatima." Hussein says, "O Hur, as you wish." On his back, on the back of his horse, he comes slowly to the tents that host the granddaughters of the Prophet. He says, "O women of the household, it is I, Hur. It is I who is guilty of bringing you to this place. It is I through whose audacity today you have been trapped in this wilderness. If only my hands were to have become paralyzed before I seized Hussein's reins. If only my tongue were to have fallen silent before I spoke against Hussein ibn Ali. O women of the household of the Prophet, do you find any forgiveness in your heart for me?" As he said this, the cries arose from the tent. Hur was moved to an extent that he descended from his steed and began to slap his face and his head. Some women came and consoled Hur, and they said, "The women cannot tolerate your pleas, O Hur. Contain yourself." He said, "And in that case, I shall go and fight for Al-Hussein." Now here we find a scene, and listen to this scene. Hur's brother gives his life. Ali, his son, gives his life. He has another son. Hur says to him, "O child, go and fight for this man. And thank Allah for bringing you here and not keeping you in the opposing camp. Go and fight." He fought gallantly. Then he came back and he said, "O father, is there any way in which I can have a sip of water, for the thirst kills me?" Who said, "Silent, O child. The son of the Prophet is thirsty. Go and give your life and ask not for water. His grandfather, if you are successful, shall quench you from Kothar." He goes, when he falls, he cries out for Hur. Hur, it is said in the Maqatil, did not go as a defeated father going to the torn body of his child. He raises his head at the back of his horse, looks with pride and says, "Did you not see how my son fought this battle?" He goes to his child, takes his head. As he's rubbing his heels, he breaks into a smile. "What do you see, O child? Do you see the paradise awaiting you?" He says, "O father, the grandfather of Hussein has come and he is quenching me with Kothar." Hur fights. Hur kills many people when the forces engage fully. It is said his horse was made lame. Hur comes to the ground. On foot he begins to fight until a sword strikes him upon the head. when the sword strikes him, we find from the Maqatil, he gives out a cry, "Oh, Aba Abdullah, your lover and your slave has fallen." Hussein hastened to Hur's body, takes Hur's head and places it into his lap, and says, "Oh Hur, by Allah, you are a free man as your mother named you a free man. The best of free men that wombs have produced." He witnesses a wound upon Hur's forehead, extracts a handkerchief and ties it upon Hur's forehead. Hur breaks into a smile. Habib ibn Madair asks him, "O Hur, do you smile that you see the grandfather of Hussein?" He says, "No, O Habib, I smile because I find my head in the lap of Hussein." I will say, "O Hur, take the good tidings that the handkerchief of Hussein shall remain upon your forehead till you are resurrected from your grave on the day of Qiyamah. Come and see the fate of Zahra's chadar as it is being removed on the 11th on the Sham-e Ghariba after the killing of Al-Hussein from the head of Zainab." Ala la'natullah al-qawmi al-zalimin wa say'alamu al-ladhina thalamu ayyamun qalabin yanqalibun. Matami Hussein.